In this video, Rafael will teach you about IoT, the Internet of Things.
Hello, welcome to today's lecture on the Internet of Things. Today, you're going to learn what the Internet of Things is, why it's a big topic right now, how you can use it and how industry actually uses it, and also what are the challenges in the Internet of Things as of now. Most of you have probably heard already about the term Internet of Things or IoT, maybe at home where you have some objects that are connected, or in your industry where your employer is talking about IoT strategies. Or maybe you have seen some advertisement of network communication companies that praise the new advent of the Internet of Things. IoT, in brief, was coined by Kevin Ashton at MIT. He defines the IoT as the connection of physical objects or things to the Internet. Through that, they can share information or data with each other. In order for that to make sense or to be meaningful, these things are equipped with sensors to sense their environment and their status. There are several building blocks for IoT. We need an identifier for the things and the objects. You know it maybe from your computer that there is an IP address that uniquely identifies you or your computer. We also need such an IP address for the things. Therefore, in recent years, there has been development of IPv6, which allows more addresses to be connected. We also need sensors. As talked before, the things need to be connected with sensors that can collect data about the environment. These sensors can be different ones. It can be for temperature, humidity, it can be for audio, it can be for filming or whatsoever. And then we need some ways and means to connect the things together. Hence, we need some communication. Also, the communication can be very different. We can have Wi-Fi, which you all know for our personal life, also Bluetooth, you all know, but it can also ultra wide band or some other communication standards. And finally, we need some computation. This computation can happen through microcontrollers that you might have heard about. For instance, Raspberry Pis are in the personal home assistance big topic, or Arduinos. There are several different domains in which IoT already made an impact. In agriculture, in healthcare, in automotive, where it connects cars with each other, or in smart home that you probably know best about, which is bringing smart products to your own home. But it also made an impact in the manufacturing industry. And we refer to the manufacturing industry and the IoT in there to the Industrial Internet of Things, or short IoT. In this lecture, we'll focus mainly on this industrial industry, but we'll also draw on examples from smart home, as this is something you probably can relate to, and I think is a very useful example to learn and teach IoT. Maybe some of you still remember those times when you had your panic button on your phone. This button which connects your Sony Ericsson to the internet, and you knew this is gonna cost a lot of money right now, and you're panicking, trying to stop the connection. Today, we all have smartphones in our pockets, which are connected to the internet 24/7, and we don't care about the cost of the connection. But what changed since then? Why is the Internet of Things now taking off instead of 20 years ago? Well, there are several different enablers that support this development. First is the availability of low cost and low energy sensors. You can get sensors like these shipped from all over the world for a little money. With these sensors, for instance, at your home, you can check whether or not your window is open and tell your heating system to stop heating when a window is open. You can also track the temperature of your room and accordingly steer your heating system automatically. So those two things are connected and talking to each other. The communication between the two things is the second enabler. The connectivity technologies have evolved a lot since 20 years, so you have new ways of sending and sharing data between two entities. The third reason is the development in cloud computing. A lot of people have already using different cloud systems for their own devices, and things can use these clouds as well to store and share data over the cloud. As a fourth reason, I'd also like to mention the developments in analytics. Even though we might collect a lot of information through these things, we still need to be able to make sense out of it. And here is where analytics, and especially its development in machine learning, helped over the last years to make value of this data. Now, after understanding what IoT is and why it is developed so fast in recent years, let's come to the fun part and look at some application areas in industry. First, we have track and trace. With track and trace, parts, equipment, or even employees can be tracked where they are located. This helps, for instance, in knowing when the part will arrive. It can also help knowing where your equipment is. For instance, if you are on a construction site, you would like to know where your machines are because otherwise they might get lost. A second example is condition monitoring. This is a prime example of applications of IoT. It helps to observe and monitor the status of machines in manufacturing. For instance, you want to know whether the press in the Hall 2 is working or not. You can just click on that in the visualization and check its status. What you can also see, maybe what is the oil status of it, or when is the next due date for maintenance. And the last part brings us to our third example, which is predictive maintenance. Through IoT, we can not only monitor the status of machines, we can also look at its development. Through these sensors, for instance, like here, we have a microphone with a built-in microcontroller that sends the data to the internet. We can hear the vibrations of the machines and check whether these vibrations are showing unusual patterns. And if these unusual patterns occur, and we know that these unusual patterns will lead sooner or later to a breakdown, we can already maintain the machine before the breakdown even happens. Another example is mass customization. Parts can now contain information and share it with machines about how they should be processed. For instance, it can tell the machine what color it should be using or which material it should be using to process this part. And thereby, the part can automatically and independently steer its way through manufacturing and steer its way about the settings they should be used to process the part. As a last example, we have energy efficiency. When parts are connected to the internet, they can also be connected to the energy provider. Thereby, machines, for instance, can be used more efficiently at times when energy costs are lower than when they are higher, thereby saving a lot of costs for the manufacturer. But even though there are a lot of different applications already developed, there are still severe challenges for IoT in the industry. First, it's a failure to create business value. A lot of IoT applications look fancy and are technically a very high standard. However, they fail to deliver value and to really save money in the end of the day. So it's always important to keep in mind what benefit can this solution bring us to the table before developing something that is just cool. Second, manufacturers today already have invested a lot of money in their existing equipment. We need to realize that we are working on a brown field with existing equipment and cannot buy just new machines because they have sensors and collect more data. So retrofitting of these old machines, equipping those machines with sensors, is a very important task in order to gather that data that is not yet gathered on the shop floor. Third, standards. There are several different ways of communication for machines and things out there. There's ultra wideband, there's RFID, there's Wi-Fi, there's Bluetooth, there's the IEEE standard, tons of different ways. And it's difficult for manufacturer to first choose, but also combine all these different standards. And this is a prime task, and I can tell you from a personal experience, this not only applies to manufacturers. Just try to set up your own smart home. You already have Zigbee, which is standard based on an IEEE standard, and you have Wi-Fi. If you have these two standards, those things will not talk to each other. At least you will have a hard time and a lot of coding sessions with your Raspberry Pi to make them talk to each other. Believe me, you need to. But even if you, for instance, choose Zigbee before your smart home, you will still have a hard time connecting Philips Hue lamps together with Xiaomi or with your IKEA Thrott 3 lamps. The example of creating a smart home can help you understand the complexity of these decisions, especially when you go to manufacturing later on. In manufacturing, on a positive side, there are already a lot of initiatives to combine these standards or to create common rules. For instance, there's OPC UA, which is a common language, and UMATI, which tries to make a own language and the unified language about communication. Fourth challenge, the obvious, security. Most of the networks, and especially also the private networks, are secured very well against attackers and hackers from the outside. However, there's this one lamp that is connected to the Wi-Fi that is also in your private network. Well, this can be the target of a lot of attacks, and this is oftentimes not secured very well. So hackers and attackers can come through that lamp that is connected to the internet and through these things that are connected to the internet into your system. And these things oftentimes are not secured as well as they should be. Finally, we need to talk about privacy. We are used to our smartphone being connected to the internet and that some of this information is read by external firms. We get personalized advertisement recommendations and other things that are based on that data. But what happens to the data that is collected in our smart home? What happens to the collected data on your usage of the washing machine? When the windows are open, or when you're, what kind of programs you watch on a television? Or maybe some of you have these little robots that clean your floor. Well, oftentimes these robots have sensors to measure your and to view your apartment. What happens to that data? Does somebody look at it? What can this person or this company do with this data? And when it comes to industrial use cases, this question is even more critical. What happens to the data of your machine? What happens to the parameters your machine is producing the parts? Are they maybe be dragged and stored somewhere else where they shouldn't? So you see that this privacy and who owns and who gets the data, gets to see the data, is a major concern in IoT, not only in your smart home, but also in industry, and even more so there probably. I hope this last part doesn't scare you away from IoT. There are tons of useful examples how IoT can help us improve our processes and make our life better. I would really encourage every single one of you to make your own experiences. Go out, try things in your smart home, but really consider all these things that we've been talking about in the challenge section. Consider who owns the data. Consider all these different standards. You will learn a lot, but be aware that there are downsides to using IoT. With that, I hope you enjoyed today's lecture and looking forward to the next time.